Well, let me introduce myself. I'm Yasin Pyarali from Pakistan, Sindh, and I belong to the University of Sindh. And the topic that today I have is investigating the issue of ideological conflicts in Usma Azam Khan's novel, The Geometry of God. She is the Pakistani writer, and she writes about the current issues of Pakistan, especially the issues related with the history of the Pakistan. And today, the topic that I've selected is ideological conflicts in Usma Azam Khan's novel. So let's start it. Now, this is the abstract that I've submitted in this conference, and I'm not going to talk about this abstract because I'm going to talk about the whole paper entirely. Just a few glimpses are there here. That in this respect, I have already talked about, that it's the topic to investigate the ideological conflicts in the novel. That ideological conflict is between two types of people or two sectors of the society. One sector of society is marginal force, or in other words, depressed force, and another one sector is dominant force or powerful force. And these two sections of the society have got two different ideologies. And these two different ideologies are actually in clash with each other, in conflict with each other. So that's why we are going to talk about that here. And
so your talk is CDA?
CDA.
It's?
CDA.
Discourse analysis, yeah.
Okay.
So this is an outline, just an outline: introduction, literature review, research methodology, theoretical framework, results, discussion, and conclusion. Let's go ahead. Usma Azam Khan has written down The Geometry of God in 2018. What does it depict actually? It depicts the Zia's regime. That is the longest regime in the history of Pakistan. Zia is supposed to be the head of the military at that time, from 1977 to 1988. And he is more like a dictatorial person. He just rules by his own power, by manipulation of all the legal and illegal institutions of the society, and trying to impose his power, military power, over the common public, and even trying to suppress the common people who are not in the favor of his own ideology. So Zia is supposed to be that type of person there. So this novel actually depicts the Zia's regime, which embodied the clashes and conflicts among different ideologies, particularly the religious mindset versus the secular mindset. Here, the secular mindset does not mean opposite to religion, but secular mindset actually means to see everything from a rational point of view, from a reasonable point of view, from a realistic point of view. Actually, what Zia tried to confess at the time is that Zia meant everything what he willed to do, what he wished to do. And we wanted every people to believe in his ideology. So that's why, and he wanted to be more like another one religious scholar among the Muslims. So that's why I just named him, because he was using all the time Islamic tag with his own philosophy, ideology, perspective, and thinking, mindset. So that's why I just tagged him Islamic mindset. And this novel also discusses the issue of ideological conflicts, which novel depicts in context of Zia's Islamization, means of subjugation and suppression manipulated through Mirza Anwar, that is the character, or the party of creation. The party of creation actually is a sort of organization depicted in the novel that is governed or ruled or organized by Mirza Anwar, a one character. And that again says, against scientific enlightenment in knowledge is professed through Zahur. Zahur is another character in the novel. So these two characters are actually ideologically opposed to each other. They are fighting against each other. On the one hand, Zahur is there. On the other hand, Mirza Anwar is there. Mirza Anwar represents the orthodox mindset, and Zahur represents scientific mindset. Mirza Anwar is against the scientific enlightenment in the knowledge or in every field, whereas Zahur is in the favor of scientific enlightenment. He always believes that whatever God has created in the nature, there is some reason, there is some logic, there is some rationality behind that creation. So we have to discover that rationality even without touching the belief of Islam or any other religion. So that rational approach is found in the Zahur, whereas Anwar, Mirza Anwar, is completely orthodox type of person, having limited, narrow-minded approach towards the things. He says every scientific invention creation is actually against the Islamic version of the creation. And that's why it is supposed to be a heretic aspect of life. So we should not believe it. I've just given that picture. Look at this picture. That shows actually the conflict between two people, or two forces, or two ideologies, or two different sections of the society. On the one hand, this one side, There's religious ideology, extremism, cultural narrow-minded approach, individualism, dominance of central power, means the military power, and blind belief. On the other hand, we've got secular ideology, that is scientific enlightenment. Another one is secular and liberal approach, socialism, equality among all sectors of the society, reason and logic upliftment, all these things. So these two forces are actually in clash with each other. Now this background, I've already talked about the term ideology is very much important here to discuss first. What is actually ideology? Most of the people don't know it. Basically, it is a set of certain presumed, perceived or cherished beliefs in the society. It is all about values, norms, interests and certain mindset about various things, objects in concrete or abstract nature. Both can be in concrete and abstract nature. What people believe collectively, mutually, what people enjoy collectively, mutually, what kind of values people share with each other collectively and mutually. These are all coming in the terms of ideology. On the basis of ideologies, the differences, clashes and conflicts between or within the societies emerge. Of course, that's true, because wherever there is a difference in the ideology, there is a slight deviation from one ideology to another ideology, we find a conflict emerging up there. And it is quite frequent in every country, I think. It's quite visible or apparent. These clashes and conflicts are mainly due to the desire to have the power in command. Why these clashes emerge up, or why these clashes are created, why these conflicts are created in the society or any kind of state, just to get empowerment, just to get dominance over other type of group that is not dominant one, or that is supposed to be suppressed one, weaker one. So this study exposes, my paper actually, exposes the transformational development of narrators from being controlled by others. This is really important. Transformational development of narrators from being controlled by others, such that family members, because there are so many characters who are controlled by others. Family controls them, institutions control them, various mindsets control them, cultures control them, and apart from this one, religious ideology also controls them. So this controlling element is there. And social values or tends to have self-realization. The word transformation development is important because there are three more characters. These characters actually from the very beginning are controlled by these other values, other people. And later on, slowly, gradually, when they try to realize their own importance and existence in the society, they to discover their self-esteem, self-realization, self-fulfillment, and developing power of resistance against being reigned and controlled. Let's go there, characters now. The issue of ideological conflicts has been narrated through characters Amal, Mehmish, and Noman. These are three characters. Actually, Zahur and Mirza Anwar, these two main characters are there. The entire novel is all about these two characters. But these two characters are depicted, picturized, portrayed by these three little characters. That is Amal, Mehmish, and Noman. These three characters talk about these two characters, main characters. I'll show you the picture later on. Okay, now there's narrators through characters Amal, Mehmish and Noman encircling Zahur and Mirza Anwar's accounts as the leading characters that stand on the opposite poles of ideologies. Usman Aslam Khan, rather than directly portraying history as unilateral and one-dimensional, has narrated it by giving voice to the marginal subalterns. This is really important. Because being a student of postmodern literature, I discovered that the most of the postmodernist writers or modernists, they believe that it's not important to write down the history from the central perspective. Rather, we can see the history from other marginal but weaker perspectives as well. So history from various points, in other words, correlative approach is applied there. So subaltern, marginal subalterns are given voice. Amal, Mehmish and Noman, the narrators. This is more like Usman Aslam Khan has looked at the history not through its center but through marginal point of view. The character of Noman is analyzed in this paper. The character of Noman is analyzed the way he faces internal conflicts and external conflicts. This is really important as well. Apart from having the ideological conflicts in the society between two sectors of the society, there is also in one character conflicts even. His external appearance as well as his internal passion, what he wanted to be and what he is now, they both are in conflict with each other. So this is also portrayed in my paper. The painful experience of working as a person. Okay, remember one thing, that Noman is actually the son of Zahur. Sorry, Mirza Anwar. Mirza Anwar is actually very religiously orthodox and fanatic type of person. And he is running the party or organization by name is the Party of Creation or Creation Party. So that person, Noman, actually works under his father, and that he does not like that work. He never wanted to be a slave of his father. He never wanted to be obedient to his father, blind obedient. He wanted to have his own life. He wanted to be something like a mathematician. He wanted to enjoy his own passion, discover his own self. So that's why...
10 minutes more,
yeah. I'll try to complete this within a time range. Okay, another one is Amal or a girl, female, faces the challenges of a patriarchal society where the family or parents always force girls to spend a traditional and conventional life as a daughter or wife after marriage, which would bound her with domestic errands and have nothing to share or contribute in the society. This is also important. The family of Amal and Mahvish. Amal and Mahvish are two sisters. Their family actually is also religiously orthodox one. And they don't want girls to go into the colleges or universities to discover something new, to contribute in the society, to be all self-dependent personalities, or to contribute something really that only people think that male can contribute into the society. So that also faces a lot of challenges there. Kant portrays the multiple voices about the relativity of historical truth in a mocking style through Amal, who generally stands for practicality of ideas and beliefs. This is the way Khan talks about these characters and the social forces in the novel. I'll just skip these slides. Now this is one. This picture is really important here. See, I've just put there the central force in this picture, and these two persons in this picture are fighting against each other. One is quite orthodox ideology, second is quite secular scientific ideology. They are fighting each other, but they are not narrating themselves. They're not talking about themselves. They're not describing themselves. They are furthermore described by these central forces. The forces on the one hand is Amal and Mahvish, and on the other hand is Noman. These three characters actually talk about these central characters. Number one is Mirza Anwar, and second is Zahur. Zahur and his scientific approach is there. Mirza Anwar and his party of creation or religious orthodoxy is there. So this is what the way Mirza, Uzma Aslam Khan has portrayed this ideological conflict in his novel. Let's go ahead. This is Literature Review. I've selected some writers or who have contributed in the field of literature on the what is the ideology, ideological forces, and ideological conflicts in the society. And there are some other writers I've selected to talk about Zia-ul-Haq's regime in the Pakistan, how strict, severe it was, and how, suppressive it was to other marginal forces or weaker forces in the society. Okay? And this is another one, Literature Review. Yeah, this is important. Research methodology, because this paper is supposed to be the part of academic writing. So that's why I've selected two approaches to evaluate this novel academically. That is, one is textual analysis. I've selected this methodology, and second is close reading method. These two approaches actually help me a lot in evaluating what is inside the book, how the book depicts itself, how the characters are portrayed in the book, how the characters reveal themselves in the book. These two methodologies have helped me a lot. Like, apart from this theoretical framework, that is really also important, because without theoretical framework, we cannot evaluate any single piece of literature. So this one, there I have selected two ideologies or two theoretical framework. One is theory of ideology, professed by Terry Eagleton in 1990s. He has given me a concept of ideology. What is ideology? How the clashes of ideology emerges in the society? What kind of ideologies actually struggle to maintain the power or survival in the society? Another one theory that I have selected is theory of feminism, professed by Tyson. Tyson is one of the most commonly read literary character, or in other words, literary critic in the society, in the literature especially. Both theories are found helpful to analyze the novel Geometry of God. Eagleton's concept of ideology is used by dominant class over the dominated class in the society, is used to analyze how the novel depicts radicalization, orthodox practices against the knowledge of science and education, and sabotaging the value and recognition of women in Zia's regime. Furthermore, Tyson's feminist perspective evaluates the novel in context with suppressive power resisted by female characters. These two theories actually have helped me to evaluate this novel. Now these are the results. Gender discrimination professed through dominant ideology. What is the most important thing in the novel is that these female characters, Amber and Melvish, they face a lot of suppression, they face a lot of discrimination, they face a lot of subjugation in the society, either through media, through institutes, schools, colleges, or university, through Islamic ideology sometimes, not because Islam properly does not suppress the women, it gives equality to the women. But to a certain extent, the people who are using the tag of Islam for their own personal and selfish means, they were trying to profess this one. So this is there. Women are inferior to men and born to live within four walls of house. As the novel says, women's meaning is defined in relation to men. As the novel also professes this discrimination. Women are taught to serve men in all domains as daughter, sister, wife, and mother. Women have no equality with men in the patriarchal society. Women are weaker, thus need to be protected by men. Now, these are the lines I have taken from the book. I want to say you should be careful. These are the words said to Amal, a girl, by a boy. That says, I want to say you should be careful and I want only to protect you. Why women are protected by the men all the time? This is the mentality depicted in the novel. I will protect you. Amal defies all patriarchal and male-made rules and remains persistent in her struggle to achieve an independent meaning. 5 minutes more, thank you. And now these are the lines, these are the words that shape that show that the Amal does not care actually what the male think about women in the society. As she said, she knows their aim is to wear her down, distract her, make her quit. She fears if her voice is heard, it will prove their success. But she tells herself that this isn't why she's silent. This is if they aren't he equal. Why should her reaction be? She deviant, a woman scientist ahead of her time. This is the persistence or resisting force power that Amal generated in herself to defend herself in the society, particularly male-oriented society like Pakistan. Mavish does not believe in her teacher's words. Mavish is another girl. She is literally blind. She cannot see by her visible eyes, but she has the eyes in her soul to see the things. She's quite curious to know the things. She's quite curious to know about the colors, to about the world, to about the objects, and to about herself, to about other people. So that's why she does. The teachers guide her to do something what they wanted, but she does not agree with them. Mavish does not believe in her teacher's words, and despite being blind, sees the reality with her inner eyes, thus achieving meaning of life as well. Now, these are more results. Characters plight in a patriarchal society and struggle to achieve meaning. Amal and Mavish, as a part of patriarchal society, were enforced to do what others, such as family and parents, wanted them to do. They did not have any freedom to choose what is best for them, as depicted in the novel. Noman, who was passionate to teach mathematics and magic of algebra in school, worked for his father as personal secretary and editor of Akhlaq reluctantly. Akhlaq is a magazine issued by his father, reluctantly. Unwillingly, he was working there. Partially to please his mother and partially lack of self-realization. He did not have any kind of self-esteem or his own existence value. That's why he was working along with his father. Later on, he discovers himself. He tries to be a self-independent, self-motivated man, and he just goes away from his father and does not work anymore for his father. I'm just skipping all these things. Another one, the result is characters plight in a patriarchal approach and struggle to achieve meaning. This is also related to the previous slide, I think. Now, this is most important. Conflict between characters is the conflict between ideologies. Of course, the characters represent ideologies. And these ideologies actually are against each other. Like this one, Amal is fighting the society, against the society, those boys who were trying to protect her or telling her to protect her. Okay, so she's against these two characters. And another one is Mirza Anwar is quite against to that of Zahur. And Zahur stands for scientific enlightenment in the society, whereas Mirza Anwar does not believe in scientific enlightenment. Mirza Anwar believes that anybody who uses his senses, who uses his rationality or reasonability to learn something new, that is actually going against the religious principles. So he says that person going against religious principles is heretic. Is what do we say in other words in Urdu or Farsi or Arabic, kafir. He goes kafir. So that's why Mirza Anwar says this one. Mirza Anwar's character is against Zahur because of these two different approaches. Okay. Now, outer Noman versus inner Noman. Noman from the very beginning was part of the work of his father. he was working to encourage the religiosity, extremism in the society. Later on, he discovered himself and he stood alone and independent and he started teaching mathematics and he started teaching magical algebra and he started talking about his own independence. So he was actually in conflict with each other previously and later on he discovers himself and gets out of that conflict. Now, this one is important as well, legitimization by promotion of dominant group's ideology. Wonderful. Legitimization by promotion of dominant group's ideology. This is really important because Jia's regime is supposed to be quite a strict one, and in this regard that he always tries to impose his decisions on others, as depicted in the novel. So this also shows that Jia manipulated so many institutes to propagate his own ideology and philosophy. That's why he legitimizes everything that he believes, he legitimizes everything that he wills to do, he legitimizes everything, either illegal or legal, either means in the favor of the people or against the people. He never cares there. Now the conclusion is, the geometry of God is a picture of persecution and plight faced by the marginal characters who did not agree with the dominant group's ideology. The conflicts and clashes that Uzma Aslam Khan, the writer, has highlighted in the novel are more serious and dynamic in their nature as they fundamentally deal with the society, religion, education, customs, state, and exploitation of social, political, and religious institutes in the favor of the dominant group. The novel represents the means used to suppress and subjugate those who deny the authority of center, for instance, in the case of religious ideologies, party of creation, and the state work out to suppress the voice of Zahur, the scientific man, while family values as a center are illustrated to subjugate Amal and Noman to be what they want them to be. On the other hand, education, reshaped in the favor of Islamic Orthodox ideology, is a vigorous effort of Mullah Military Alliance to infuse radical ideology. Miss Fozia, a teacher of Mevish, she says, Miss Fozia, as a teacher, works for the dominant group's ideology to suppress Mevish's use of senses and passion for art, drawing, and science. Okay, last one is, Uzma Aslam Khan's characters in The Geometry of God stand persistent, self-determined, firm, and struggling to achieve their own meaning in the life in the novel. Thank you so much. These are the references. Thank you so much. 13 is, I think 13 minutes were not enough for me.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much, Bari Yasin, for this.
Any questions are welcome.
And a debatable topic. Yeah. Now, the floor for discussion. Yes, please, doctor.
Yes.
It's okay, I can hear you. You are all
okay. Thank you very much for this nice presentation. Ideology has been defined differently by different scholars. I hope that you refer to Van Dyck's, Fairclough's, Rodek's definitions, because they are the leading scholars in this regard. Although the text is a literary one and they are mostly philosophers and linguists, as it is known. Ideology, you defined it as an explicit?
Of course, ideology is an approach I have taken here. It's just a framework.
I think ideology is an implicit approach
to a certain
extent. Society, discourse. Yes, because the ideologist writer uses different styles, tools, in order to, for example, to abuse language or ideas in order to fabricate something hidden in text. The underpinnings of discourse are not clearly explicit, because explicitness is something positive. Ideology is generally a negative description of belief.
No, sir, it's not negative description, it's just an opinion. Let me clear you.
Ideology is not a normal opinion.
As I read Terry Eagleton's concept of ideology and the ideological conflicts, then certainly he just cleared my thing that the forces in the society, they mostly have different ideologies. Why? Because they sometimes belong to different areas. For example, here in Iran, how many provinces are there? 33 provinces are there.
Yeah.
And all 33 provinces, to a certain extent, differ from each other. I'm not saying religiously they are different, no. But to a certain extent, they've got their own recognition, their own identity. Khuzestan is completely different from Tehran. Tehran is completely different from the Shiraz. Why? Because there are some traces, some differences they are there. But in other countries, these ideologies, for example, where the religion is supposed to be the base, and where other forces, other perspectives of dwelling a life are supposed to be the base, they always are in clash with each other. And because of this clash, the dominant sector, the dominant force, always tries to suppress the weaker one.
What are the
that does key, not lead
the
weaker
and this is the
person.
Point. Power and
yeah,
dominance
and
the,
I got
the basic
this from
aims
Eagleton.
Of ideologization. I agree with you.
Yeah.
So, to be an ideologist, you should uncover or hide your notions,
yeah.
ideas, opinions, in order to convince others indirectly rather than direct.
Manipulation.
Yes, it is a kind of manipulation.
Yeah.
Indirect persuasion rather than an explicit rhetoric.
But sir, sorry,
this is the
I'm
point
not
on.
Manipulating ideology here. I'm just saying
yes.
what book consists of. I do not even agree
yes.
with the writer of the book. Personally, that's my personal opinion. I'm quite religious man by appearance and by belief as well. So, but what is written there is a literary critique. I just try to expose
in
it.
In your analysis, you indirectly used the term negatively. Because secularists are against religious, for example.
To
a certain
extent, you can say, yeah.
Yes, theologists,
yeah.
we can say. And theologists are against secularists.
Yeah.
And they have hidden conflicts sometimes.
Most of the time.
In their text and discourses.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. This is my point.
I think he doesn't deal with this subject from a linguistic point of view.
No, because
yes.
I belong to
literature.
Literary
criticism.
I just
yes.
belong to
not
literature.
CDA.
This
yes.
is one.
Yes, this is the problem.
I do agree.
Yes.
I just
but
took
philosophically
this
ideology
is
not
ideology.
CDA.
Because linguists, are, those who study linguistics,
yes.
always try to impose it on
yes.
others.
Yeah.
yes. not,
this is my man defending me.
Yes, it's literary criticism, not critical discourse analysis.
Yeah, I just
maybe,
took this.
Yeah.
I told you
the normal definition
this is just
of
a framework.
Ideology.
Ideologically,
yes.
it's just a framework here. I've taken to analyze this overall novel. I did not take it from linguistic perspective,
yes.
how it is there in the minds of the people through linguistic perspective. No
yes.
way. I just
yes.
applied it to evaluate this novel
literary
apparently.
Yes.
Okay, as a literary critic.
Yes, yes but yes, I think that your model you try to present here is valid for not only for literature,
mm-hmm.
but also for journalistic discourse, etc.
Yeah.
So there
yes.
Interdisciplinary.
There are interfaces.
Interface.
Yes.
Of course, literature is a broader field,
yeah,
I think. It includes
yeah,
linguistics,
even
it includes journalism.
Clashes of civilization. Of
most of the
time,
there are. That's quite visible.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for your comments, sir. Any other person?
Two more questions.
One, which is.
Yeah, please.
Concerning the novel. As the theory of James Fillon, he presented to the characters in two types of characters, mimetic, thematic, and synthetic. So what do you think the novel or the novelist here tried to represent by the two people or the two clashes between the protagonist and this novel?
I think here the writer has applied a deconstructive approach. It has subverted actually the fundamental dimension of narrating the history. It has just not, it has portrayed center through the marginal points of view.
Yes.
In the beginning, what was there, the writer, hero, or protagonist himself was trying to portray himself. Okay, or the protagonist or the main characters were portrayed by a third person narrative. But here, no, here the sub-marginal or sub-altron forces are depicting the center.
Are they mimetic, which means that they are representative or real life? Characters in the
we
novel,
can say.
Or this thematic, either the themes of the society, or the synthetic, which is the characters that sometimes the feminism ideas, or someone just like to move the story So are they thematic on mimetic in this novel?
Of course, the themes are already there because it's literature. Without themes, literature is nothing, I think.
Because I can see they are both in a sense that mimetic. They present some kind of people in the real life events.
Yeah,
they
and
seem
also
real
thematic,
characters. Yeah,
real life persons, and they are thematic in the way that they represent two ideas, ideologies.
The background regime has been taken. That is reality. Background regime, that is Zia Huq's regime. He was a military head and ruled for the longest time in the history of Pakistan, over Pakistan, and Pakistan people tried to subjugate all what we say rebel or revolutionary forces in the Pakistan and tried to impose his own ideology on the people of Pakistan. That is reality. But apart from this one, the characters are not real. They are just depicting the history from different angle.
I know, but they represent people that they are real.
To a certain extent.
Yes,
yeah.
They are
real. Yeah. I agree with you. Thank you so much.
But there is some caricatures, of course.
Yeah.
Yes, there are some caricatures in there. For example, Amal. This is, for me, as you presented, this is a perfect caricature of a woman living in Pakistan.
In Pakistan. Back to 20 years back, and she was trying to do something that is never done before by any girl or woman in the society, especially that patriarchal society. So that is caricatural, I think.
But this book,
But this book was published in only in Pakistan or
in Pakistan 2008.
Yeah. Only or translated in other countries?
No, it's already in English only.
Written in English.
Yeah. Yes. Usma Hasan Khan actually lives in Sydney. I think she wrote it down.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
My pleasure.
Now the floor for Vidisha Praksha.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You want to use your laptop,
I think? Yeah, I don't.